Another application of first order ODEs is mixing and concentrations. And this is also one of those things that it feels like you've done stuff like this. Like if you have blah, blah, and you add this much, and then it does a da, da, da. And I remember doing something like this in algebra, and I was like, I don't understand why we're doing this. So now I know why we're doing it. It's because eventually I was going to take ordinary differential equations, and I need to know how to do stuff like this, except this is in no way the way we did it in eighth grade. So anyway, the idea of first-order ODEs, mixing and concentration, is that you have this rate of change. It's kind of like the ultimate rate of change problem. Anytime you have a rate of change, you always have like a rate in minus a rate out. And you just have to kind of figure out what goes in there and then solve the resulting differential equation, which is kind of super amazing. So let's say we have this problem. So the idea is that we have this tank that has a certain amount of salt in it in 600 gallons of water. We have water that contains a half pound per gallon that comes in at 4 gallons per minute or GUPM. Then we drain it out at the same rate. So it's getting drained at 4 gallons per minute. How do we talk about and describe mathematically what's actually going on here and what would be the steady state or the limit as T approaches infinity? And then we want to actually find the concentration of salt at any given time. So I said that the key to solving all these problems is this rate in versus rate out, or the rate in minus the rate out. Now, when you're talking about rates, it's really, 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 really important you pay attention to units. So I'm just going to write this, units matter, okay? So half the time, you can solve a lot of these problems just by looking at the units. So whenever you have a rate, and you're looking at salt, so we're specifically looking at how much salt is in the mixture at any given time. So if we're looking at d salt, d time, so d salt, d time, then that means if we're doing a rate, then anything that we do, the rate in and the rate out, both have to be in the units of pounds per, and I think we're all in minutes. So anything that we do has to be in the rate of pounds per minute, because our d salt, d time, that would be it. It would be pounds per minute, okay? So we want to think about the rate in, and I'm going to zoom out a little bit so we can still see this for a second. So if we're looking at the rate in here, the rate in is going to end up being, so you might say, well, it's going in at a rate of 4 gallons per minute, but I'm like, no, remember things that have to be in pounds per minute. So you kind of like go back to old school discussions of units and unit conversions. I have a half a pound per gallon that's going in, and then I have 4 gallons going in per minute. Okay, and what's important about this is the gallons are going to cancel out, and I end up with 2 pounds per minute, and that's what I'm looking for. So the rate in is going to be 2 pounds per minute. The rate out, that's a different story, because you don't actually know what the pounds per gallon of the mixture is anymore. You know that it's still going out at 4 gallons per minute, but you don't know what the pounds per gallon is of it at the time. You really don't. Now, it's important to note, though, that we've decided that this Q is going to be how much salt we have. So, in fact, what we have is we have Q pounds of salt in 600 gallons of water. So, I'm going to say that again. We have Q pounds of salt under 600 gallons. You're like, I don't know what Q is. I'm like, I know you don't know what Q is. That's the point. This is a Diffie-Q class. There's all kinds of unknowns. So, we don't know how much salt is actually in the mixture, but we have given it a name, and its name is Q. We also know that because it's draining and adding at the same rate, that there's always 600 gallons in the tank at a time. That's not always the case, but in this particular case, there's always 600 gallons of water. If the water was pouring out or pouring in at a faster rate, then we'd have to adjust the number of gallons by that rate of change. But as it stands right now, we don't have to, so we can actually simplify this to say that we have Q over 150 pounds per minute going out. So that means that we've got that dQ dt is equal to a rate in of 2 minus a rate out of Q minus 150. Okay, now we're back to more of a standard differential equation, and we can solve it from there. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and do something. What am I going to do? I'm going to make this 300 minus Q over 150. All right, so that I can have 1 over 300 minus Q is dQ is equal to 150 dt. Integrate both sides. Natural log 300 minus q, except there's going to be a minus out front, equals 150t plus c. Put the negative sign over there. Doesn't matter about the constant. E to the negative 150t times some constant. It's equal to 300 minus q. Q is equal to 300 minus c, e to the minus 150t. So that's a good little starting point. Now I need to find c. I can find c. If I scroll up, it told me that at time equals zero, there was 40 pounds of salt in the tank, right? Yes. At time equals zero, there's 40 pounds of salt in the tank. Now, why am I using the 40 pounds of salt instead of the 600 gallons? Remember, it's because I'm specifically looking at pounds of salt. That's what Q represents. Q represents pounds of salt. So I say, okay, well, at time equals zero, I've got 40. So that goes over to 1. So that means that C is equal to 300 minus 40, 260. All right, so if I plug everything in, I've got Q is equal to 300 minus 260 e to the negative 1 over 150 t. That is my, whatever you call it, my equation that describes the activity. Now, if I'm looking for a concentration, my concentration, we'll call it K, is just equal to the amount over the total gallons. So amount over total gallons, because a concentration would be pounds per gallon, just like a rate would be. So I could say it's 300 minus 260 e to the negative 150 over t divided by, it's not really that exciting, I just wanted to, you know, show you that there was more to it, and I can simplify it, of course. But more importantly, okay, is it asked us specifically what is the steady state. So how do we find the steady state? Well, you know, because that's what the problem said. We want to find the limit of this as t approaches infinity. So as t approaches infinity of q, the 300 is going to stay the same. We've got minus 260 times e, but it's negative, so over 150 times infinity. Again, we're dividing by zero. Are you starting to see a pattern here? This goes to zero, so the steady state is actually 300. What's amazing about this? I'm going to plug this back in, and I'm going to get the exact same thing. I'm just going to write it a little bit differently. Bam! Did you just get, like, ODE'd? You just got ODE'd, because this is amazing. Look at this here. I've got the steady state. Steady state. And I have my initial condition minus my steady state. Again, I see that transient response. So the same pattern keeps coming up again and again and again. That any almost half, well, most of the time whenever I solve problems like this, I have an initial condition and the steady state. So at any given time, the concentration, or not the constant, well, the concentration would do the same thing too, because we're just dividing by a constant. But the amount of salt in the system is going to be the steady state plus the initial condition minus the steady state times e to this time constant. So this is just all kinds of crazy. Some version of this is going to come up at any time. Now, it's not always the case, so you can't just jump to the end, but whenever you see that, then you should get kind of like super excited and stuff. So let's try one more problem, and we'll see how this all works. Actually, before I go on, I wanted to kind of point out that we're almost stating the obvious in a way. So basically, the idea is we have this limit, and we said that the limit was going to be 300. Well, this is really where we found the limit. So we're saying that, okay, the steady state is 300. Now, somebody could just go, like, seriously, we kind of knew that already, because we have this tank, it has a certain amount of salt in it, but ultimately that whenever you're pouring in water, the water has a rate of a half pound per gallon, which means that if you have 600 gallons of water and you're pouring in a mixture that's a half a pound per gallon, that really you're never going to get a concentration higher than than that at a steady state, because eventually you're going to replace all the original water with this new mixture of concentrations going in. That's a half a pound per gallon. So that means you're going to always get right at 300 pounds of salt. So it's one of those things where we do all this math and then we get the answer and we're like, well, I could have done that without the math. But it kind of makes us happy when we get an answer that actually kind of makes sense after the fact. So that was neat. So here's a problem to work. So you basically got this tank. It's a bigger tank than it starts off with. So it originally only has 10 grams of salt in 200 liters of water. Now it's a 500 liter tank, so that means you can actually put more water in it. And we have water with a certain concentration being poured into the tank faster than it's being drained. So we have it going in at 4 liters per minute. It's coming out at 2 liters per minute. And we want to describe this equation, or come up with an equation that describes this activity until the tank actually overflows. Now, the problem that you're going to come into here is that the rate out description math is actually going to be more complicated than it was on the previous problem. But in any case, I want you to go ahead and pause the video, see how far you can get. It might take a while, and it really should take a while. So don't just be like, I didn't solve it in 2 minutes. I'm going to give up and just look at the solution. Because once you've seen the solution, you can't go like solve it without having seen the solution before. So seriously, pause the video, see how far you can get, and then come back. So we're going to assume that that happened. All right, so when we're looking at the rate in, I don't like that. I'm going to do it another color. So the rate that we have on the tank going in, again, our units here are going to be grams per minute. Did I say meter? It's minute. Liters per minute. I think I said minute. From part of me thinking I said meters. It's not. But I'm looking at grams per minute. So the rate in, thank you, the rate in is going to be, this one's pretty straightforward. I've got 1/4 grams per liter, and it's coming in at 4 liters per minute, so clearly we have 1 gram per minute. Rate out is going to be a little bit more difficult, because we know that it's coming out, so if it's going in at 2, or in at 4 and coming out at 2, it's 2 liters per minute, so I have to multiply by something in grams per liter. Now, we discovered last time I can just say it's Q grams per, but what do I put on the bottom? Do I put 500? Well, no, because it's not always 500. Do I put 200? No, because it's not always 200. At any given time, I don't actually know how much water is in the tank. I can figure it out if I know how much time it's been, though. So if you think about it, I started out with 200 liters, and I had 4 go in, but 2 go out, so that means every minute, I gain 2 more, okay? So that there is what needs to go underneath. So if you did anything but that, you didn't do it right. If you got anything but Q over 100 plus T grams per minute on the rate, oops, out, how come nobody told me? Rate out, if you got anything but Q over 100 plus T grams per minute, you didn't do it and get it set up right. So go ahead and pause the video and then try to rework through it again and see how far you can get. Because if you start off with the wrong thing, it's not going to work, obviously, because it's, you know, wrong and stuff. So Q is equal to the rate in minus the rate out. So again, if you haven't already, or sorry, QDT, pause the video, see how far you can get. If you're like, I don't even know what to do next. Well, remember we had this thing where we had homogeneous solutions, and then we had to guess the new thing, and you're like, no, but that was like a long time ago, and I don't remember how to do that anymore. Well, guess what? You need to know how to do stuff. So go remember, go look that up. Go figure it out on your own. If you just sit here and watch, you're not going to get anything out of it. This is all like active learning and stuff. So let's pretend you did that. Plus Q over 100 plus T is equal to 1. So I'm going to solve the particular, not the particular, the homogeneous equation first. So I have dQH dt plus QH over 100 plus T is equal to 0. I have to separate this, or I have to do this, because I can't separate this. This is a non-separable equation. Now, because I know how to do this, I can say that this is equal to some constant times e to the negative 1 over 100 plus t dt. So I've got qh is equal to C e to the negative natural log of 100 plus T plus C. Well, there's the C right there. QH is equal to, because I can, instead of having the minus sign out front, I can just put it up here. So then it's e to the natural log, and then that just flips that. So it's some constant times 1 over 100 plus t, like that. Okay, so if you didn't get this far before, pause the video, see if you can take it the rest of the way. So now that we have the homogeneous solution, we can go through here and make a guess. So in the past, what we've done is you said, okay, so I'm going to guess that, well, before we did y is equal to u times u homogeneous. Well, now we're just saying that q is equal to u times q homogeneous, or u times 1 over 100 plus t. So remember what we do is we actually are going to plug this into this equation right here and see how far we can get. So u prime times 1 over 100 plus t plus u times the derivative of that. Oops. 100 plus t times negative 1, and then the derivative of t, which is just 1. So I'm going to plug that in to, like I said, this equation up here. So I've got q prime 100 plus t minus u. Oh, it's supposed to be a negative 2. Duh, that's where that negative 2 went. I just put it in the wrong place. U over 100 plus t squared plus q over 100 plus t. And I guess that q, I lost my place. Q is equal to that. So q is equal to q over 100 plus t, but it's divided by 100 plus t, so that's actually squared, and that equals 1. I know that I did something right, because this term in the middle is going to cancel out. So I end up with u prime is equal to 100 plus t. So that means that, come here, that means that u is equal to 1 half t squared plus 100 t plus some unknown constant c. So if I combine that, ooh, where'd you go? So if I combine that with my guess, I guess that q is equal to u times 1 over 100 plus t. So that means that q is equal to u over 100 plus t, which is great. If I want to, I can multiply the whole thing, well, not the whole thing, I can multiply the top and the bottom of this by 2, just because fractions make me sad, and I've already got one fraction I can't get rid of, so I've got t squared plus 200 t plus c. It's still the same c, it's still just an arbitrary constant since I haven't actually plugged in anything yet. So 200 plus 2t, like that. Now, I want to come up with a value for c, and the way that I do is I have to go all the way back to my original equation. Remember why I was even doing this in the first place. I said at t equals 0, there is 10 grams of salt in the system. So that means that there's 10 grams of salt in the system at 0 plus 0 plus c over 200 plus 0. So that means that c is equal to 2,000. So q is equal to t squared plus 200 t plus 2,000. Now note that this isn't fitting into our e to the negative t thing at all. So there's no like initial steady state transient response. And that's because, quite frankly, there is no steady state response, because if I keep doing this as t goes to infinity, I'm just going to end up with an infinite amount of salt in the system, except for the tank's going to overflow. So there is no steady state. Tank overflows. So this is kind of an interesting, after I showed you everything that falls in the pattern, now of course I'm going to go and show you something that doesn't. So our total quantity of salt at any time until it overflows is going to be represented by this. The concentration is going to be equal to q times the amount of water in the tank, which we said was 200 plus 2t, and so then it's really just a question of simplifying that. So It's pretty good, making all kinds of progress here, learning all kinds of stuff. Hope you had fun.